This is unit 6.3. We're going to talk specifically in this section about double replacement reactions. This is going to be very short. It's only a few pages in the book that you need to read. That's 389 to 393. And then in your word guide, it's only really two pages, 160, 161. So let's get started. All right, so specifically double replacement reactions. Now remember, a double replacement reaction has two products. And we're going to look at these solubility of these, or in other words, do they dissolve in water? And so in double replacement reactions, if one of the products is insoluble, which means it does not dissolve in water, then that is said to be a precipitate. So that is a new vocabulary word for you, precipitate or precipitate. And that's just a solid that is in a liquid, that develops in a liquid. All right, and I also want you to know that sometimes double replacement reactions are also called precipitation reactions. If there is a precipitate, then it's called a precipitation reaction. Or you may see or hear this on other YouTube channels or other YouTubers. Tutors call this double displacement. Displacement. But officially, it's double replacement reactions. All right, so here's an example of a precipitation reaction. If we take potassium iodide, and that's what's in this beaker right here, this clear liquid, so you don't see anything, it looks like water. But if we look at that on a molecular level, potassium iodide is considered soluble in water. So that's why you don't see any chemicals in this water. It just looks like water. But on a molecular level, what happens is the potassium ions and the iodine ions split apart from each other. Since this is soluble, then they split apart from each other and they float around as ions in that water. And this is a better way actually to represent this than Ki. And that's what we're going to be talking about in this section. Now in this beaker here, we've got the lead nitrate. And again, lead nitrate is soluble in water, so that's why you don't see anything here. So on a molecular level, again, the lead ions separate from the nitrate ions, and they're just floating around in this liquid. However, when we react these together, so when these two are poured together, then you see this yellow start to appear. Now, this is the precipitate. This is the solid part that is not soluble in water. And then we can see the final picture here that because it has more density than the liquid around it, it's going to sink down to the bottom. So on a molecular level, again, let's look at this right here, the lead iodide and the potassium nitrate, now that they've been mixed together. And that's what you see in this picture here. So down in the bottom, these purple and gray spheres, this is the lead iodine. So the lead iodide that forms the solid, it's going to sink to the bottom because it has more density. And that's this right here in the picture. However, the potassium nitrate is still soluble. So you see here the potassium ions and the nitrate ions are still separated. It's still soluble and floating around in this part right here. So this is called a precipitation reaction. And when you write this reaction, the potassium ions and the nitrate ions that we get over here do not become part of this reaction. So they're called spectator ions. Okay. And that's a new vocabulary word for you. So I'm going to write this in. So the nitrate and the potassium ions that don't get involved in the reaction are called spectator ions. And just like spectators in sporting events, they're there to watch. They don't get involved in what's going on. All right. And just for being official, there is another kind of reaction, double replacement reaction. It's called a neutralization reaction. We're going to talk more about these when we start talking about acids and bases. But when you have a strong base like sodium hydroxide, which is what drain cleaner is, and you combine it with a strong acid, which is hydrochloric acid, you know, hydrochloric acid can melt metal. And so that's what you see happening here in this beaker with the Mountain Dew can. It's actually dissolving the Mountain Dew can. When you mix those together, a strong base and a strong acid, then it's going to have a reaction and it's going to produce HOH, which remember I told you was the same thing as water, plus sodium chloride. Now, sodium chloride is a salt, and just so happens that when you mix these two, you're going to get salt, which is the same salt that's in the ocean. So that's why I have this picture here. You're going to get salt water. Now, the salt is soluble in the water, so it dissolves, and so you get salt water. So it completely destroys the sodium hydroxide, which is a strong base, and it completely destroys the hydrochloric acid, which is the strong acid, and it makes harmless, everyday salt water, which is kind of cool. You can take these two things that will melt your skin, combine them together, and then just get some normal salt water that you can just float around in and read your newspaper and get a good tan. All right, so let's talk specifically about net ionic equations, which is the first equation that I showed you right here. Okay, these are called net ionic equations. Well, there are certain steps that you need to do to get a net ionic equation, and I have these steps listed out, so go ahead and pause the video and then come back and we'll talk about them. Okay, so the first thing we need to do is identify the ions that are in the reactants. And so right here, I have sodium chloride reacts with silver nitrate. Well, we have to identify the ions. Well, if we have words like this, well, what we have to do first is we have to get the formula. So sodium chloride. So what would be the formula for sodium chloride? Well, it tells you right here, sodium. And so we know that sodium is Na. So we're going to write Na. And it's an ion, so we have to put the ionic charge. So sodium is a plus one. We know we get that from the periodic table. And then we have chloride. Ide comes from ene. That's an element on the periodic table. So we have Cl. And that's a negative charge, negative one. So we have our positive one, our negative one. They cancel each other out. So you just smash these together. So the formula for sodium chloride is NaCl. Okay, this reacts with silver nitrate. So let's do the same thing here. So we have silver, which is Ag. And if we look on the periodic table, we see that it's in the stair step with aluminum. So we're going to have aluminum here, right? And then we have zinc here. And then we have silver here. So if aluminum is always a plus three, the stair step, this is plus two, stair step, silver is going to be plus one. Okay. Oh, let me get a bigger eraser. All right, so silver is always a plus one. So we have our silver here, that's a plus one. And then nitrate, well, nitrate is a polyatomic ion, so we're going to look on our polyatomic ion list and see that's NO3. It's got a negative one charge, positive one, negative one. They cancel each other out, so you're just going to smash it together. So silver nitrate is going to be AgNO3. Okay, and so we see AgNO3 right here. Let me just move this out of the way. All right. So our first step is really getting our ions. Now that we have our ions, then we can recombine these cations and anions to form the compounds for the product. Well, since we know this is a double replacement reaction, then there is going to be a switch, and the two metals are going to be the ones that are going to switch. So the sodium and the silver are the metals. They're going to switch places. So our product's going to be sodium. And now sodium's not going to combine with chlorine. It's going to combine with nitrate, which is NO3. Okay. Now sodium has a plus one. NO3 is a negative one. So you just smash those together, and that's the correct formula. Reduce this a little bit again. Okay. And then we're going to have another product, which is going to be silver combining with chlorine. So we have our silver combining with the chlorine. Okay, so again, we had to balance the charges. Silver's a plus one, chlorine's a negative one. Those cancel out. So that's going to be the formula. We don't have to have any subscripts. All right, so if we recombine these to form our new compounds. Okay, let me get rid of this so it doesn't distract you. All right. Sorry, I meant to grab that and move it over here. Just move it out of the way for now. Okay, so identify the states of the new compounds. Now, what that means is it soluble in water? Okay, so right here we have AQ. Now, AQ means aqueous. When you see this, it means that this is soluble in water. Now, sometimes you're going to see this. Sometimes you're not going to see this. So if you do not see this, then we need to figure out if it's aqueous. So this is where this chart over here comes in. And you have this in your reference materials. I'm going to show you how to do this. So what you're going to do to find if this is soluble is you're going to look up either the cation or the anion on this chart. So let's see if we can find sodium on this chart. All right, so we're going to start here at always soluble. So always soluble are the alkali metal ions. And remember, that's group one on your periodic table. So I put it in parentheses here. This includes lithium, sodium, potassium, rubidium, and cesium. Well, sodium is an alkali metal ion, so it's always soluble. So we don't even have to look up the chlorine part of this. We already know if it's bonded with sodium, sodium's always soluble. So this is going to be aqueous. So you see there, it does have aqueous there. All right. So let's look over here, silver. Okay. So silver is obviously not an alkali metal ion. So we look at these polyatomic ions. Silver is not a polyatomic ion. It's not there. So it's not in this always soluble. So let's scale down here to soluble with exceptions. So we see chlorine, bromine, iodine, fluorine, sulfate. So it's not there. Okay. So let's go to insoluble with exceptions. So oxygen and hydroxide, that's not silver. So we're going to go on to these polyatomic ions plus sulfur here. And we don't find sulfur there. So we didn't find sulfur anywhere on this list that is not an exception. So, okay, so you probably saw silver is here, but it says that it's an exception and it lists silver as an exception. Okay, so it's easier just to look here to find what you're looking for on the solubility chart, the left-hand part. So what we're going to do now is we're going to look for nitrates. Since we didn't find silver, let's look for the nitrate. So alkali metal ions, well, that's a polyatomic ion, so it wouldn't be an alkali metal. So let's look NH4, NO3. So right there it is. So NO3 is always soluble. So if we didn't see that, then we could also, let's see, is nitrate down here? No, it's not. But we'll look at this silver that was right here in just a moment. So for now, nitrates are always soluble. So that's AQ, that is soluble. All right, so let's look at our products because our products don't have that. We need to find out if any of these products are soluble or insoluble. All right, so sodium nitrate. Well, we just looked at this. Sodium's always soluble, and nitrates are always soluble. So both of these, that's a double whammy. This is definitely soluble. So this is definitely AQ right here. That is soluble. Now, if you don't remember that, that's okay. You just come back over here and look. Alkali metal ions, sodium is always soluble. We don't need to look up the nitrate. All right, now silver chloride. Well, when we were trying to find silver nitrate, we didn't find silver over here anywhere. So I remember that. So I'm going to look up chloride now. So it's not an alkaline metal ion. It's not one of these polyatomic ions. So if I go down here to soluble with exceptions, we see chlorine right here. So chloride ions are always soluble, except when they're bonded to silver, lead, or mercury. And so in this case, it is bonded to silver, so that's an exception. So where chlorine's always soluble, it's bonded with silver, so it's an exception to that. So that's going to make it insoluble. All right, and if it's insoluble, it can't be aqueous, so it has to be a solid. Or I guess it could be a gas. But in this case, where we're doing these, then it is soluble. I'm sorry, solid. Okay, so it says here, identify these and one should be a precipitate if you have a net ionic equation. Now, that doesn't mean that every single double replacement reaction we have, one of those are going to be a precipitate, because that's not true. Both of these could have been aqueous. And in that case, then this would not have been a net ionic equation. There would be, what you would do is write no net, okay? No net ionic equation if everything is soluble. But if we're going to have a net ionic equation, which is what we're talking about, then one of these is going to have to be insoluble, which is going to be the silver chloride. All right. And it says here, do not separate solids, liquids, or gases. So this is a solid. So when we go to write out all of these ions, we're not going to separate this one. So the next thing that you're going to do is you're going to rewrite this equation, and you are going to separate all of these that are aqueous. Now, you should always start off with a balanced chemical equation. So sodium and sodium, that's one and one, so that's balanced. One chlorine balanced, one silver balanced, one nitrate balanced. Okay, so this is already a balanced equation. All right, so now we can go ahead and separate them. So what you do, since this is aqueous, is you rewrite this, but you write them as ions. So sodium plus chlorine. Now make sure that you put your charges here. All right, plus, this is aqueous, so we're going to have to write these as Ag, and that's an ion, so that's plus. Plus NO3, and that's a negative ion. All right, now, we're going to rewrite our sign. Sodium nitrate is aqueous, so we're going to split that into ions. So we have sodium plus nitrate, and the nitrate is a negative one, plus, now this is a solid. So remember, do not separate solids, liquids, or gases. So I'm not going to separate that. I'm just going to rewrite this just like this. All right, now it says eliminate the ions that appear on both sides. Well, look at both sides means both sides of this arrow. So here we have sodium. So I'm going to come over here and look and see if I have one sodium ion, and I do. So I'm going to cross this out. Okay. Chlorine. Okay, I look over here. I do not see a chlorine ion. Now, I have chlorine, but it's not an ion. It's bonded with silver. So I have to see this exactly, and I don't. So silver ion, I look over here, and I do not see a silver ion. And then finally, your nitrate ion. Right here is a nitrate ion, so I'm going to eliminate those. All right? And then you're going to rewrite whatever's left. And it doesn't matter if I write the chlorine first or the silver first. It doesn't matter. Some people like to write the positive ion first and then the negative ion because that's the way it's bonded, but it technically does not matter. So I'm just going to write it the way I have it in the equation. So chlorine plus 1 mole of silver yields AgCl. So this right here is what's called the net ionic equation. You have eliminated the ions that don't get involved in the reaction. So this is your net ionic equation. All right. So from something we learned about 5 minutes ago, what are these called? The ones that you eliminated. So it'd be this one, and this one all have the same name. Do you remember what those are called? Spectator ions, because they're not involved in the reaction at all. All right, so let's do another practice. Aluminum chloride, all right? So we have aluminum, which is Al, that's a +3, okay? And then we have our chlorate ion. All right, so this ends in 8. So it is a polyatomic ion, that's ClO3. Now let me show you the polyatomic ion just to make sure that you know where I'm getting this. All right, so chlorate right here, chlorate ClO3, and it tells you the charge right here is a -1. All right. So -1. All right, so put these together. This is a 3, this is a 1, +3, -1, that doesn't cancel each other out. So in order to get a correct formula, we're gonna have to swap and draw. So this is gonna be Al, and then in parentheses, I'm gonna have ClO3, and I need 3 of those to balance this out to a neutral charge. Okay. Now potassium hydroxide, well, potassium is K, that's a +1 charge. Hydroxide is a polyatomic ion and it's a -1 charge. So let's go back to our reference materials so I can show you where I get those. All right. So potassium right here, potassium is in the group 1. It's got a +1 charge. You see that up at the top. And then I forgot what the ion was. Oh, hydroxide. All right. So hydroxide is right here. Hydroxide OH right there. And it's a -1. So you had to remember these polyatomic ions. You just had to remember to look at the chart to get these. All right. So +1, -1 cancel each other out. So this is going to be KOH. We just smash them together. All right, so this is going to yield double replacement reaction. We're going to switch these up. Aluminum hydroxide. So the aluminum is now going to combine with the hydroxide. And we have to balance the charges. So aluminum is +3. We saw that. Hydroxide's a -1. So we have to swap and drop. So we're going to add parentheses here and write a 3 here. Okay, plus. Now the potassium is going to combine with the chlorate. So we're going to have potassium and then chlorate, ClO3. Potassium is a +1. Chlorate's a -1. Those balance out. So that's the formula right here. All right, so this is our equation. Now we have to balance it. So we have 1 aluminum here, 1 aluminum here. That balances out. We have 3 chlorates, so I need to put a 3 here to make 3 chlorates. That gives us 3 potassiums here. So I'm going to have to put a 3 here to make 3 potassiums here. 3 hydroxides, and then we see here hydroxide that has 3. So this is a balanced equation. All right, so our next step is to find out if these are aqueous or, soluble or insoluble, so we can write the AQ or the solid there. So aluminum chloride, let's look back here. So we don't find aluminum anywhere on here. So we're going to look for ClO3. So right here we see ClO3. This is always soluble. So anything that contains ClO3 is always soluble. So this is aqueous. And I can come over here and automatically write that this is aqueous because it contains ClO3. So I did two at one time. All right, potassium hydroxide. So I know potassium is an alkali metal ion, so it is always soluble. So K is always soluble. So I can come over here and say that this is soluble. Anything with a K is soluble, but I already have that as aqueous, so it doesn't change anything there. So the only thing we're looking for here is the aluminum hydroxide soluble or insoluble? Well, I know aluminum's not on my list, and I know that because of experience, so I'm going to go ahead and show you anyway. Aluminum is not an alkali metal ion. Aluminum is not here. All right, so it's soluble. Aluminum is not there. And then insoluble, aluminum's not there, and it's not one of these. Okay. So what I'm going to have to do then is look up the hydroxide part of this. Well, hydroxide is not here. Hydroxide OH is not there. But insoluble, I see hydroxide right here. So insoluble with exceptions. So hydroxides are insoluble unless they're bonded with an alkali metal, which are these, and it's bonded with aluminum, so it's not. Sorry, is it aluminum? Let me look back. Yes, aluminum. So it's not an exception here. So NH4, CaSr, and Ba, that's not one of the exceptions. So hydroxide, aluminum hydroxide is insoluble. Okay, so this is going to be a solid. All right, so there's our precipitate. Aluminum hydroxide. So we're going to rewrite this equation with these that are aqueous separated. So here I'm going to have aluminum, that's a plus three, plus. Now, this is kind of tricky. I have three of these chloride ions. See this three of these chloride ions. I'm going to take this and I'm going to make it a coefficient to say I have three of these chloride ions. So when you're writing it as an ion, these subscripts become coefficients. So three of these chloride ions plus, this is already a coefficient. So this is also kind of tricky. Well, I have three potassiums. Okay, potassium is plus one. I also have three hydroxides because coefficients, remember, are a multiplier for all of the species that are after it. So I also have three hydroxide ions. All right, and then there's our arrow. This is a solid, so I'm not going to separate it. So I'm just going to write it and keep it together just like that. Plus, this is aqueous, so I have three potassium ions here, plus three chloride ions here. And make sure you write all these charges because these are ions, so they have to have those charges. All right, so we're going to eliminate the ions that appear on both sides. So do we see an aluminum ion on this product side? We don't, so I can't mark that out. Three chlorate ions, three chlorate ions, so I can mark those out. Three potassium ions, three potassium ions, so that gets marked out. Three hydroxide ions, I don't have three over here, so I can't mark that out. So the chloride and the potassium are the spectator ions. So we're going to rewrite this equation, leaving the spectator ions out. So I'm going to have, let me switch back to black. Aluminum with the plus three charge, plus three hydroxides to yield aluminum hydroxide. Now, this should already be balanced, okay? Because we've started with a balanced equation, your net ionic equation should already be balanced. So let's just check one aluminum, three hydroxides, all right? So this is your net ionic equation right here. Okay, easy peasy, easy. All right, so let's do one more example. And this is a, calcium iodine, silver fluoride. All right, so this is a double replacement reaction. So calcium is plus two, it's in the second column. Iodide is a negative one, it's a halogen. Plus two, negative one, so that's gonna be CaI2. Swap and drop, plus silver fluoride. All right, so silver is plus one. Fluoride is fluorine, that's a negative one. Okay, so those do cancel out. So we're gonna do silver fluoride yields. All right, so we're gonna swap the metals. So this is gonna be calcium fluoride. All right, calcium is a plus two, fluorine's a negative one, so we have to swap and drop. So that means that there's gonna be a two there, plus silver is gonna be with iodine. All right, so silver's a plus one, iodine's a negative one, those cancel out, so we just smash it together. So that's the formula there. And I'm going to move this over just a little. I like to leave room after the plus sign. So in that case, if I need to have a coefficient to balance this, I'll have room to write it there. Okay, so let's balance this. One calcium here, two iodines here. So I need to put a coefficient there for the two iodines here. This makes two silvers here. So I need to put a coefficient here for two silvers here, two fluorines, and two fluorines. So this is my balanced equation. All right, so now I need to find out if these are aqueous or not. So calcium iodine, let's start off looking for calcium. It's not an alkaline metal ion, and it's not one of these, so it's not always soluble. Soluble with exceptions, I don't see calcium here. Insoluble with exceptions, I don't see calcium here, and I don't see calcium here. So I am going to check the other ion, which is iodine. Iodine's not an alkaline metal ion, it's not here. Soluble with exceptions, there's iodine right there. All right, so iodine is soluble, except for when it's bonded with silver, lead, and mercury. So is it bonded with silver, lead, or mercury? It is not. It's bonded with calcium, so that would make this aqueous. Okay, so it's soluble, because these are soluble with exceptions. So iodine is soluble unless it's with these, so that's soluble with exceptions. All right, so let's look over here. Iodine is what we were looking up, right? So iodine is soluble unless it's bonded with silver, lead, or mercury. So we can go ahead and do this one. This is silver, so it becomes insoluble here because now that's an exception. So there is our solid, our precipitate. Now, silver fluoride, well, we know silver is not on this list over here because we just tried to find silver. So let's look and see if fluorine is in here. So it's not one of these. Fluorine's right here. So after you use this chart a while, you'll get to remembering where all of these are. So fluorine's right here. So fluorine is soluble unless it's bonded to calcium, strontium, barium, lead, or magnesium. So it is soluble unless it's with one of those. So is it with one of those? Oops, I went the wrong way. All right, silver fluoride. Fluoride is soluble except for, and silver's not on that list, so that is going to be soluble. All right, so I'm going to write an AQ here. All right, so we just need to see if calcium fluoride is soluble. Okay, so we looked. Here's fluoride. Is calcium an exception? It's soluble. Yes, it is an exception. So calcium fluoride is an exception. So this is not soluble. All right, so this is also a solid. All right, so this is going to be kind of tricky because we have two solids here. So these are both aqueous. So let's go ahead and separate these. So we have calcium ion, that's plus two. We have two iodine ions that are negative one, plus, now this one, we have two silver ions that are plus one, and we have two fluorine ions that are negative one. All right, and this yields, and these we're not going to split apart because they're solid, plus two AgI. We're not going to split that apart because it's solid. All right, so crossing out all the ions that appear on both sides, well, we don't have any that appear on both sides. So this whole thing, without eliminating anything, is your net ionic equation. We're not going to be able to cross anything out. So this whole thing is the net ionic equation. We have two solids here, and that is possible. So just because that there's not one that's aqueous or soluble doesn't mean that this is not a net ionic equation. It is. We just have two precipitates. Okay. All right. So that's net ionic equations. Make sure that you slap that like button right across the face, hit that notification, and subscribe. Bye.